So morning all. I noticed that we have some friends that we've not seen before. We got a team from the Spoken Tutorials project, it seems. You joined the class, is it? Okay, good, good. You know, I've been thinking of how to do all this thing that we have to do more meaningfully. Okay, and I'm open to ideas. I feel that the way not to teach communication skills is by giving a lecture to 700 people. You don't learn that way. Best thing we've discovered is you learn by doing. So we're going to learn by doing. Okay. So what we are planning is to see how to integrate all those elements, all those little building blocks of the lectures every week into something meaningful at the end of the course. If you have some ideas beyond what I'm saying, please let me know and we'll try and see if we can make things more interesting. So my exercise is how we can make these contacts every week interesting and maybe even exciting. Okay, and I'm looking for ideas. So the reason, how many of you have been able to have a look at a TED talk? Oh, excellent. Okay, how many of you have made notes from that? Great. And how many of you had not seen a TED talk before this class? Even better. Okay, good. That means you've discovered a very interesting resource. I discovered it a few months ago and I thought it was great. Okay. So what the plan is, that we want to give you enough hathiyar in your hands, communication skills, hathiyars in your hands. So by the end of this course, you will be able to make your own TED talk. Okay. The TED talk, the content of it, we'll decide. But what I'm planning to do is maybe reduce a little bit of time in the class, leave you more time offline, and perhaps from next week, break you up into two batches, right? We have about 110 people in this class, so about 55 on Tuesday and 55 on Thursday. And we'll divide you up further into groups of 6 people each. Right, so we have about 9 groups on Tuesday and 9 groups on Thursday, and your goal is to start conceptualizing, producing and delivering a TED talk of about 3 to 5 minutes by the end of the semester. The shorter a video is, the more difficult it is, as Shama will tell you in her spoken tutorials and all that. To make things concise is much more difficult than to have them rambling on. And advertising people are superb at this. Within 10 seconds, they have to communicate everything about a product and make you want to buy it. Okay. So there are two things we can do. Is you have to relate a difficult concept or an idea to a particular audience. Right. So I'm thinking that one of the things that we could do is to take Project Oscar's topics. They are trying to teach computer concepts to school kids. Okay, they're trying to teach computer concepts like networking, data structures, all these kind of things to school children. Okay, now one challenging thing to host as a TED talk is to help them with their project, and along with their computer masti books and stuff like that, have a short tutorial, say a 5-minute introduction to a particular topic, which you guys can make. So that's a possible challenge that we can look at. We can even look at maybe some aspects of spoken tutorials, although I've not thought a bit about that. Or if your group is willing, you can pick up something that you're very passionate about or something interesting that you have to say and negotiate with us the type of talk that you want to deliver, right? Or some of you might want to take your research areas and extract something out of there, some concept out of that, and turn that into a stimulating talk for a 10th standard child, right? So now you have to explain complex concepts to a reasonably bright audience, but without background. How will you do it? That's the challenge. And I feel that if you can crack this, you've learned a very, very important skill in life, and you'll need all these things: listening, note taking, reading scientific articles, all these kind of things that you need to do. Presenting, body language, how to talk, all these kind of things. How to put up a presentation, right? Which is easy to read. How to choose the colors in the presentation. So all these little weapons, all these skills that you need along the way, we will teach you, right? So today is the most fundamental skill that's given your first initial script or some plan that you have or a paper that you've written, how to convey changes that need to be done to it to somebody who might be the author, right? And I would urge you to do this in your seminars and your MTPs also, where if you've written anything, try and have it proofread by a friend and have them correct it. You don't do it yourself if possible, at least the last draft. Because you'll be surprised as to the number of errors that remain in a document if you correct it yourself, because you don't see those errors, right? And you'll find that your friend will also learn a little bit about what you're doing. In fact, it's quite interesting. In my PhD, right, I won't recommend this to guides or students. I used to meet my guide once in a few months, and we used to have chai together, and that was it, right? And most of the work was done by us PhD students who were sitting in a big room. This was at Oxford many years ago. And in trying to explain my problems to a colleague, one would often come up with an answer to it. I remember right towards the end, I was really frustrated, and you know, I was stuck at a particular topic and nothing is happening and so on. Then in a corridor, I was explaining this to a colleague of mine who's a brilliant mathematician, I remember. And while explaining to him where I was stuck and how I was stuck, right, I figured out the answer to the problem. So I can't underestimate the value of being able to articulate problems to others who are not as involved as you are in the problem, right? So I'm hoping that this will encourage you to share your problems and your MTP topics and seminars and all that with your friends, because you'll find insights that you might not have thought of. Okay, so I won't hold this class up any longer. I have given you a kind of plan that we hope to implement over the next few weeks, right? So we'll have the class split up into two parts. One part will meet on Tuesday. One part will meet on Thursday. We'll split up each class into groups of 6 people each. And now we will start working with you as groups, where the group has to start conceptualizing a TED talk that they want to do by, say, the end of a month and a half's time. And we still want to continue with the videoing of each individual here as to what you expect out of the class and where you come from and stuff like this. I'd like to complete this documentation of each of you by maybe next week, right? Next week is an interesting exercise. Prakash Vaidya has a lecture on comma. How to use comma in English. What's a big deal, right? But it makes a big difference, right? Punctuation in your grammar, right? So he's going to sort of present you with that next week. And this week, we'll continue with the proofreading class, where you already got the sheets of proofreading symbols. Now we are going to distribute some text that you have to proofread. But first, maybe, okay, fine. So what we can do is first we can proofread your matter, and then we can have them exchange or shuffle the text that they've come up with, right, in summarizing the TED talk. And they can proofread that and submit that. So that your assignment submission, if you like, is to give these sheets back to us and also the sheets that you have. So on the sheet that you have, you'll have to write your own roll number as the author, right? And the person who corrects it will put their roll number and we'll get back to you. Okay? So we'll give you details of how this class is evolving, right, over the next few days. And if you have any feedback, maybe you can route it to us through the class representative. Who's the class rep here? Your name is? Okay, do you all know him, by the way? Who doesn't know him? Okay, so you better discover him and route Any feedback that you have formally through him, and if there's anything that you want to say to me, you're most welcome to. You catch me in the class, or you mail me at kavi@cse, and we'll take things from there. So, Prakash? Okay, any questions or any reactions to what I'm saying? Okay, you can catch me whenever you like.
Good morning. We'll spend a few minutes just reviewing our last lecture. Has anybody prepared a summary of last lecture? Now, can you just tell in a few sentences what was covered? Okay, what I'll do is, since we are running short of time, I'll present my summary. You compare your summary with that. So this was the lecture. We first considered what is called edited English, as apart from ordinary English or spoken English. Then we saw that there is a problem, and it's a severe problem. It can be a severe problem, and we won't even know the severity till we learn. Next, we saw that the average manuscript which comes out starts with 30 errors per page. Then we, in one pass, we reduce it to 3 errors, in next pass to 1 error, and finally to 1/10, that is 1 error in 10 pages. So it's not possible to reduce to the last stage in one pass. Howsoever careful you do it, you can't reduce it in one pass. So it has to be an iterative process that you have to do repeatedly, and every time you will get a decade fold reduction. You will divide by 3 or divide by 10 every time. Then, since this has to be done repeatedly, it's difficult to do yourself, even if you are competent to do that. Because first time around, whatever mistakes you miss, you will miss the same mistakes in all successive attempts. So not only you can't repeat yourself, you can't even do it yourself, because if you have written the manuscript, then those errors are part of your thinking and you won't detect your own errors. So this has to be done in a group, or at least mutually. You should have a partner with whom you can do this together. And if you have many eyeballs seeing your manuscript, it's likely that it will get refined. So this was only the background of the problem. Then we went to the methodology, that the manuscript or typescript that you prepare must be single-sided and it must be double-spaced. Unless you are confident that your initial error rate is very low, you keep it double-spaced. Then we saw that we have to use some standard markings so that we can do it together, and in fact you can communicate with anybody those errors. So we studied those markings during last session, and we have one page reference of that, which everybody has a printed copy. One thing which we did not cover is, while correcting, that's why I have star marked it, use red color. Okay, it should stand out different from the text itself. Otherwise, your markings are likely to be missed by the person who corrects it. So normally red is preferred. You can use green also maybe. Blue is difficult to distinguish from black. So use red, and use either gel pen or sketch pen or fountain pen, but not a ball pen. You try using a ball pen and you will find it difficult. Because you have to make very small marks, and ballpen doesn't start writing unless there is some rule. So like commas and full stops, etc., you will find difficult to mark. Your markings are going to be very short. So use a pen which, in which the ink flows, and you don't have to press or rub against that. So this was our last lecture. Now we have to apply that knowledge. So what we are doing is, we have a one page text. Again, we are distributing one copy to everybody. So at the bottom, there is space for name and roll number. So everybody should put their identity over there. So it says this is an assignment. So this will be collected back. Has everybody got the sheet? Who hasn't got?
Sir, how many students?
110.
Sir, I have printed in fact 150.
Oh, I see. Yeah. Good. Does somebody have extra? There is some confusion. He says he had printed 150, so they shouldn't get lost.
Everybody has got.
Everybody has got back rows.
It was taking time to distribute.
Okay, fine. So now our exercise starts with 9:55. What you do is first just go through the manuscript. We are not in a hurry for time. We have to only correct one page. Then you will see that there are line numbers marked on left, so that we can exactly identify where the error is. So you go line by line, then mark the error in situ using the marks if possible. If you can't use the mark, you make any mark with your writing instrument and put a corresponding note in the margin. If you are closer to left half, you put it in left margin. If you are closer to right half, you put it in right margin. So that while counting errors, we can only count the columns. We don't have to look inside the text. So this is the procedure. You go through line by line and correct right up to the end. After you reach the end, you again go through, because you might have missed some errors.
Right here on the
yeah. should be able to count them.
Just using the symbols.
If possible. Otherwise, you just identify the error and mark. Make a tally.
What symbol do we use for spelling error? What symbol do we use for spelling error?
You correct the error.
Right there.
Right there. Right there you correct. Otherwise, you just make a mark here that there is a spelling error.
So what should, I mean, how should I make that mark?
No, in that line, if you write up, you make a mark here.
What kind of mark? Any?
Just now you write spelling error.
Spelling error.
So you can
so
write
I'll underline the error and...
Plain language, you just
want
to count them. Yeah, in your language.
So, you align it to look towards that?
Yeah, yeah, you say align. You write in plain text just now, later on we'll use symbols. See, just now if you are confused about which symbol to use, if you have identified the error and you are not sure, you don't bother about the symbols. Symbols you can map later on. You write in plain language, we should be able to just count the errors in a line. So just now don't bother about the symbols. We'll show which symbols the model answer later. Symbols are not important. For you to identify which is first important. So don't bother about it.
Supposed to correct any errors, sir, what we have to put the symbols right here or on the left one?
You do whatever you can. Just now we'll show the model answer, then you will know. Okay, so just know that you're not in. You're identifying the error is more important. To identify where the error is and make a marking because we are going to count. Make a tally mark. Just a vertical line saying that there is one error here.
Okay.
Yeah.
Like this.
Anyway, you should be able to count them. Just now, symbol is not important. Okay. After you finish, you again go through, because you have time. After you finish, you again go through. times means? There is one error. You just make a mark here that there is one error. You just want to count the error just now. Symbols will bother later.
Which symbol to use for spelling mistake?
Spelling mistake? Just now you write spell.
Huh?
You write spell.
Okay.
Just now you don't bother about standard symbol. Later on, you can transform it into standard symbols. Okay. Just now you just identify the error.
Okay.
Mark your own way and make a marking in the column.
Oh, side.
So that we can count these tally marks. Carrot mark, no? While in school, which we have learnt, mark like this.
This way?
Yeah, either way.
Okay.
And then put that here and put the letter. For anything, you use a carrot mark only.
Mm-hmm.
Whatever you want.
Z is to be replaced by S. I just write S underneath.
Strike
it
and write S.
Okay, underneath it.
Yeah.
Here.
We should be able to count the errors in columns.
Okay.
So you mark the error again over here. After you finish, you go through again.
Happen?
You go through again.
Yeah.
You will find some more.
Spelling is wrong, then should we write the correct spelling or just SP?
Write the correction.
Correction also, okay.
Yes.
replace this by this. So this is your strength. Put the right letter here.
Here
you use this transpose symbol, okay. Interchange, and put the same, and you make a marking here that there is an error, because we want to count the tally marks here to know the error. So which symbol you use is not important. Yes. Finish, you can go through quickly.
Yeah.
You can also go around and see how many people are finishing. Okay. Go through once again. After you have finished. So we'll close the exercise and I'll display this.
Do it now, dear.
You need not use a symbol. I have told everything. You just make a tally mark.
That you have to explain.
You just make a tally mark.
Give them 5 minutes at the end to correct other people's those scripts of the TED Talk.
On the other, whatever they have brought.
And submit.
Okay, fine. Back to you. Okay, friends. But who has finished? Who has finished at least once, means reached up to the end? Okay. Who hasn't finished even once? Everybody has finished at least once. So now we'll try to close this exercise. I'll tell you how to close. You might be confused about which markings to use, etc. What you do is, in a line, if you have identified there is some error and you don't know how to mark it, you just make a tally mark in the column. Either right column or left column. Preferably, if it is in right half, you make in right column, but you can make anywhere in the column. So you just convert your things into tally mark if you have not made any mark in the column. Tally means just a vertical line you put there, that there is one error. And next, you count either tally marks or error markings in left column, tally marks in right column, and at the bottom there is a table provided. There you enter the figures, that how many errors are in left column, how many are in right column, and how many are total. You total it and keep it. Okay, has everybody totaled? Who has not totaled yet? Okay, you just count them and total. Okay, has everybody totaled? Okay, we'll start the solution. What I have done is, this is your assignment. I have put an overlay on that, on a transparency. We will go through line by line.
Yeah, we'll just take a quick tally. How many people have found less than 10 errors? Nobody has. Everybody has found more than 10 errors. 10 to 20. Okay, about 20. Lot of people. 20 to 30. You might have found more error than there are, eh? Which is itself an error. Okay, 30 to 40. And above 40. Okay, so 40 is the upper limit. Now we'll see the actual solution, that how many errors are there. So this is the first line. Authors as proofreaders. See, this is a title, so it should be centered at the top of the manuscript. So the two reverse brackets on left and right are meant for that you center. And it says center, CTR, in circle. Then authors as proofreaders, normally in title all words have first letter capital. That is what we understand. But there is an exception, that if you are using conjunctions, etc., and such words, then if it is less than four letters, it is not capitalized. If it is more than four or more letters, then you capitalize. For example, Times of India, the O of OF is not capitalized, because OF is only a two-letter word. So here as is a two-letter word, so A is not capitalized. So it says lowercase. The error says lowercase. Next line. Next to next line. The word book has come out of the column. So it says push this inside and flush left. FL is flush left. Next line is after book comma. Yeah, comma is there. That is because the quotation has ended. I don't care what kind type of you use for my book. This is a quotation. Now you have to give a comma there, because now you are coming out of the quotation. See, the quotation has ended after book. No, it is correct. That when we study commas, we will know whether it is outside the quotation mark or inside. Then Mayaki author once said to the publisher, but please print, this is again a quotation, because now you are back to the author. So before but there should be inverted commas, but please print the proofs in large type. Here the quotation has ended, so after the full stop you have to put inverted commas again. That is this. With current technology, such a request no longer sounds ridiculous. This L should be removed from this line and added to the next line. Why? So when you break a word, you have to break on a complete syllable. You can't have half the syllable sitting in previous line and half in the next line. So you have to know the pronunciation of the word, that where the break occurs. And dictionaries many times give the breaks for complex words. So ridicule, the Q has ended and less belongs to the next line. So this is delete the L, and here it says put L there. To those familiar, the spelling is wrong. So between L and A, you have to put an I. With typesetting and printing. Yet even today, type is not reset. This spelling is wrong. It has to be except. So there is a mark saying that you put C here, then EP after that, and it says transpose. In? after printing. It should be a full stop. Comma should be replaced by full stop. Okay, to correct errors. Now here the first thought has ended, and now you are talking about proofreading. The first word says. So here you have to give a para. This is a para mark. It says this reverse P. That new para should start here. Proofreading is an art. The A has to be lower capital, and the craft was deleted. But then the proofreader realized that and the craft is also required. So now what to do? So he has put dot 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 below that and says straight, that let this remain as it was. Because and the craft is also true. All authors should know the rudiments that A is extra. So you just say delete and close. Thereof, comma, though no proofreader expects, here there is a confusion you can make out that one line has become got twice. The first of these lines, the whole line should be deleted. So whole line is crossed out and it says delete. So no proofreader expects them to be masters of it. Watch not only for misspelled or incorrect works. This should be words. Though spell check will give you works as a correct solution. Spell check will not detect this. If, since you know the content, you cross K and write D. Often the most elusive error, this elusive word is wrong, it has to be elusive, that which escapes your detection. It is not elusive. So it is elusive. Instead of ILL, you have to put EL. And since there will be a gap because you are replacing three letters by two letters, you have to say clothes. This is Roman D. Where? No, this is not symbol for delete. That D is for works, K being replaced by D. This D is this K being replaced by D. It is first error in that line. It is not delete. Then most elusive error. Now since you have started a bracket here, you have to close it after error. So this is a symbol for showing that this is right-sided bracket. And this is if you cross it twice, because there are three kinds of brackets, square bracket, curly brackets, and round brackets. This is a symbol for round bracket. But also for misplaced spaces. That D has to come next to E. So you say join up. And between D and S, there should be a space. This is space. Unclosed quotation marks and parenthesis. Parenthesis is a singular, parenthesis, S-E-S is plural, and parenthesis always come in pairs. So we have to replace this I by E. And improper paragraphing, there is, should be improper. So transpose, O and R are to be transposed. And learn to recognize the difference between an M dash, which is a long dash, used to separate an interjectional part of a sentence, that is to highlight some part of the sentence, and an end dash, this small dash is shown, used commonly should be inverted, it should be commonly used. Used commonly is not the correct. So it says transpose. Between continuing numbers. Here a bracket should start, because the bracket is closing at the end of the line. So, e.g. pages 5 to 10, that should be M dash. This AND is wrong, it should be A, because this is AD, which is the symbol for the year, Anno Domini. And A with small, with two underlines, means it is small capital. Similarly, D should be small capital. It says next small capital, because AD is written in small capital, not in full capital, not in lowercase. And 1165-70, this should be N dash, it should be a longer dash, not a hyphen. And the word dividing hyphen, word dividing should have a hyphen in between. This is the symbol for hyphen. Whatever line is underlined. So I think we will stop here. But I will tell you the tally. The official tally for this is 53 errors. And you can see that nobody has gone above. What was the maximum? 40. Still 40 is a very good score. But you can know where we stand. And we will be improving as we practice. This is a artificially constructed paragraph. Okay, so we will be collecting these assignment sheets.
I think this class is very important. Maybe we'll continue this in the next class, because I am I find this very useful also, and I think you all should be very well acquainted with it. So we'll go through the remaining text in the next class, and then we'll go through your own scripts. So please bring them along next time also. Okay. Next Tuesday at 8:30 in the morning. Yeah, but we'll keep the class together in the next week at least. Yes. So the class will be kept, all of them, on Tuesday and Thursday next week.
But yeah, keep your things, bring it next time.
Please keep your scripts.